How's everyone doing? Does everyone have the in-class exercise in front of you? And is your name on it? And everyone's going to turn it in, right? You're not going to keep it? So today, for the in-class exercise, if you can take a look at it, you'll see something like, you'll see basically a collage of plan and section. And the idea is that it's slightly grayed out, so you can draw on top of it. Your job, and this is something that schools used to do in the Beaux-Arts tradition, your job is to design a facade for this building. And while you're at it, you could do a roof plan as well. Basically, this is the annex complex as reconfigured by Sasaki Associates back in the 80s. They were asked to take a look at the annex buildings, and they fixed the problematic section. What's wrong with the section organization of this building? What is it?
It's not ADA compliant.
What does that even mean? Wheelchairs can't get around. What does the ADA stand for? Americans with Disabilities Act. What year was that passed? 91. But good. And so how is it that Wentworth is getting away with not having... It's grandfathered in. Yeah. And every once in a while, we throw in a temporary elevator, and sometimes the elevator works. But it's a source of embarrassment that if you are wheelchair bound and you want to be an architect, I guess technically you could go here. But good luck. So Sasaki Associates fixed the plan and section. So taking a look at these drawings, are you able to read what's going on here? So the section is fixed so that we have the ability to install elevators that serve every floor across the complex. So on the left, our plan and section, which you can elaborate on if you want. But on the right is where the real business is, and the top right is where we're most interested. The top right is where, with your x-ray vision seeing in grayed out lines what the section of the building is behind the facade, you get to put a facade on the building. And the facade for this building is to be in the Beaux-Arts style. So this is not studio. This is not what we expect you to do when you graduate. Although when I graduated, it's immediately what I had to do. I was doing the renovation of a Beaux-Arts building in downtown Manhattan, the federal courthouse. And I was, my job was to interpret Beaux-Arts architectural vocabulary in redesigning this historic structure, the Supreme Court, the Federal Supreme Court building, downtown Manhattan. And from there, I was immediately hired by I and Pam Partners because I knew about historic interpretations. But typically, it's not what we expect you to do when you graduate. This is an exercise, a quick in-class exercise. It's not studio. If your solution is a bit cartoonish, that is fine. As a matter of fact, it probably deserves to be a little cartoonish because it's an in-class exercise. It's very quick. And your job is to demonstrate your grasp of Beaux-Arts features of architecture. Questions about the in-class exercise? Okay. So what is that, a picture of? Have you seen this before? We haven't seen this photo before in lecture, but you've seen these buildings in a different view. They're black and white. Do you want to make a guess? Paris Opera House, good guess, but incorrect, but good guess. Other guesses? What is that? It's in the United States. Is that a hint? Yes, it's the one they built and then tore down. What was that? She's giving you guys a head start. She's got her points. How about you? It's in the United States. It was built and then turned down. Matt. 1893 World Columbian Exposition. Who's got a city? Chicago. Yes. So we're circling back around to Chicago in this lecture, as we do sometimes. Here's an example of the kind of questions you might encounter on the next exam, sometimes called a quiz. The Beaux-Arts movement is defined by eclecticism, among its other features, right? Name a building that reflects this design attitude and describe how it is eclectic. I don't know, I haven't heard the lecture yet. But maybe I'll pay attention during the lecture to see if I can answer this question as we go along. Using a specific work designed by Richard Morris Hunt, describe at least two of his contributions to architecture and the role he played in the larger history of the United States. Well, I haven't heard the lecture yet, and I've never heard of this guy, and I'm a little skeptical. Architects don't have anything to do with the larger history of the United States. Do they? We'll see. Should be 1893. The 1893 World Columbian Exposition, Chicago, was called the White City. Using at least two examples, how was it influential for the development of the American Beaux-Arts architecture? I should get rid of the word "the." Daniel Burnham and Edward Bennett developed the Plan of Chicago. Describe and explain at least two strategies that were part of the Plan of Chicago. So here we go. The topic is Beaux-Arts architecture. And Beaux-Arts is a French term. Once again, here we are doing French, the influence of French. There's a lot of French terms in this lecture. You guys don't remember having taken French in high school, even though some of you did, just statistically. But whether you, whether on your transcript it says you took French in high school or not, These are important terms that are part of our day-to-day life in architecture, like the word poche, right? We already covered that. So the school itself was built in phases, and as we talked about previously, there were two stages of studying this. You copy line for line exactly what was there, and in doing so, you understand how classical architecture was produced, and then you use that knowledge to improvise. It's almost like going from classical music into jazz. Well, not quite jazz, but producing new classical compositions. How many people grew up playing music of some kind or singing? Okay, so the analogy to musical terms is very clear, and it might make things easier. Right, you learned classical techniques, even if you later were a star of your high school jazz ensemble. It was based on knowing the principles of classical music. So Félix Duban was a student at the L'École des Beaux-Arts. He later won the Rome Prize. You guys know about the Rome Prize? What is the Rome Prize? Who do we know who's won the Rome Prize? Well, Tony Garnier won the Rome Prize when he went to Rome, and instead of doing classical stuff, he did drawings of the industrial city, which we looked at the last lecture on housing. Who else has won the Rome Prize? Professor Mark Klopfer won the Rome Prize. I bet others in the faculty have won the Rome Prize. It's still going. You could win the Rome Prize. You get to go live in Italy for a year. So it's still happening. The Rome Prize was the goal of every student enrolled in the École des Beaux-Arts. They knew that only one of them was going to get it at the end of the final year of the program, and so it was a cutthroat atmosphere of intense competition where only one superstar could be identified in any graduating class. Why am I telling you about this kind of social cultural thing that was happening in the L'École des Beaux-Arts? Because over 100 years later, here we are, the architecture schools of North America in particular are still struggling to overcome some of the dysfunctional cycle drama of the culture of architectural education that we've inherited from the L'École des Beaux-Arts. So there are good things and there are less so good things. And here in this image we see after Félix Duban's 1867 renovation, he gets enclosed with, I don't know, what is that? What is that made out of? What is that roof made out of? Iron. What kind of iron is that roof made out of? Is it steel? No, it's not steel. Is it wrought iron?
Is it wrought iron? Is it cast iron? Why is it probably cast iron?
Because it's
arch. Why?
Because it's bent.
Because it's arch, yes. Because cast iron is good in compression. And bad, it's bad, cast iron is bad in tension. Did you see trusses? Oh yeah. So it's in probably a mixture of the two, right? So you see the cast iron elements are the ones that are arced, because you can't do that with a hammer. It's very difficult to do that kind of arch with a hammer on an anvil. So it must be cast. But then there are trusses, and since wrought iron is superior in tension than cast iron,
The trusses, which have diagonals, some of those diagonals are in tension. At some point, they're all in tension. Those diagonals must be out of wrought iron. And so here it is again, more recently, where they've taken out all the elements. Here's the front courtyard with Felix Duban's reworked Beaux-Arts composition of a facade, where he is using references, freely choosing from classical elements. So he, as a student at the L'École des Beaux-Arts, he copied the great antiquities of Greece and Rome. The curvature, the arc, the arches are Roman elements, and once he knew how to copy, once he knew how to reproduce exact replicas of Roman architectural elements, he could then combine them freely in new compositions. Just as if you were, you could now, if you studied the compositional style of Bach or Beethoven or Mozart, you could create new pieces of music that you might be able to convince people were composed by one of those composers. So L'École des Beaux-Arts was first founded in 1648, but as we've been learning all semester, France was a turbulent place. First, the Revolution of 1789, and then further revolutions in 1848, another one in 1871, and then the most recent one was May of 1968. And each one of these revolutions were in part cultural revolutions. And so whenever France was getting more democratic, like in the original French Revolution of 1789, the rebels would attack the École des Beaux-Arts. Why would they attack the L'École des Beaux-Arts? Why would the people's movements of each of these revolutions march to the L'École des Beaux-Arts and shut it down, which they did repeatedly until it was finally ended in 1968. There is a school there now, but it's less committed to the classical traditions. What is it about the culture of the Beaux-Arts that would inspire revolutionaries to march there and shut the thing down? Why would they do that? Well, you can think about that. So the attributes of Beaux-Arts architecture is that it's not an engineering school. It's not a polytechnic. It's not the Institute of Technology of architecture schools. It is the art school of architecture schools. It uses very clear, powerful, parti formal ideas, right? You still use the word parti in class, right? Raise your hand if you've heard the word parti. Now raise your hand if you know what the word parti means. So what does the word parti mean? What does it say there? I think it might mean a singular formal idea capable of driving the entire design. Does that make sense? Is there something else to it that I'm missing? What is it? Is it a what? No, it's okay. So you've heard your studio professors use this term, parti. So who's keeping a list? We've got poche, parti. So symmetric composition. especially of facades, and a clear functional hierarchy. So there needs to be a center, a dominant, and subordinate. And so compositionally, you might have a dominant mass and then subordinate masses, just in terms of massing strategies. But you want to organize these dominant, subordinate elements symmetrically. The circulation pattern tends to be highly rational. That's why when we were looking at the Houses of Parliament in England, even though it was done in Gothic Revival, when we look at the plan view of the Houses of Parliament in London, we notice a very clear circulation pattern, which gives us a sense of the Beaux-Arts ideas at work, even though it's expressing itself not as classical, but as Gothic in the Houses of Parliament. Among the most important things is you need to make a big statement. There needs to be a monumental aspect to the Beaux-Arts buildings. So keep this in mind as you work on your transformation of the Annex building. You need something monumental in that facade. You need to maintain a symmetry. And the symmetry is taken for granted, and that's how we can have one half of the drawing be in section and the other half in elevation. One half of the plan is a plan view. The other half of the plan is available for you to produce a roof plan. The assumption there is whatever you draw on the right side as a facade, as an elevation, is just mirrored on the left side. It's an exact replica. And that's one of the fundamental characteristics of the Beaux-Arts. And so the kind of drawing strategy that you have on this in-class exercise is built into it. Now, here's a word that I'd like to introduce to you. It's an art historical term. When a facade is not flat, when there's lots of three-dimensional movement in and out, we call it a highly plastic facade. It's not the way normal people use the word plastic, but it is an architectural historical term that is useful for you to have access to. And so a highly sculptural facade with lots of projections is considered a highly plastic facade. It's very expensive, so we don't see it much, but that's the idea. And this idea of eclecticism, we saw this in the quiz questions, the sample quiz question at the beginning. What does eclectic mean? Well, let's see if there's any information on that as we move forward. But as the Beaux-Arts evolved over the 19th century, it started out being very true to classicism and eventually opened up more and more to influences and reference points beyond classical architecture. And here's another French word that I'm emphasizing a lot because I want you to be ready for the graduate program when one of our methods of development of the thesis is the analytique drawing. And so this is a fundamental principle of the Beaux-Arts where there is a strong relationship between the details of architecture and the larger expression of architecture. We're going to see that again in the work of Frank Lloyd Wright. We're going to see it again in the works of others over the course of the rest of the semester. And it's something that I think is commonly talked about in the design studio, that the big idea that you're working with in studio should manifest in large scale aspects of what you're designing, as well as the smaller details. And this will become more and more important as you move towards the comprehensive studio in junior year. And finally, an active roofline. So often the Beaux-Arts buildings would have multiple sculptural elements, and we've seen this before. So part of the analytic drawing method is this other French word called an esquisse. So we have poche, partie, analytique, esquisse. An esquisse is a type of drawing that relates plans to sections, to elevations, in maintaining the orthographic relationship. Can I say the word orthographic? Do you know what orthographic is? In freshman year, when you were taught how to draw a plan and section, did we use the word orthographic in your presence? Who's heard the word orthographic before? Raise your hand. Can you figure out what it means? What does it mean, please?
It means a right angle drawing.
Yes, there is a right angle relationship between the plan and the elevation in the drawing on the left. Correct. So when you draw plans and sections, they relate to each other in 90 degrees relationships. And if you go from the transverse section or the short section and you move to the longitudinal or long section, that's also, you're shifting your cut plane by 90 degrees in plan to take that next section. So all of these drawings, these are considered orthographic projections. They exist in relationship to the three-dimensional whole in 90-degree twists. And here on the right, what you see, this is an analytique that incorporates several elements of esquisse. You see the plan view pocheted in a figure-ground method of drawing, where the solids are black, pocheted, and the voids are white. And above it, in orthographic relationship, you see a split elevation section where the elevation is on the left and the section is on the right. That is the kind of drawing that you are producing for your in-class exercise. Does that make sense? So, back to Garnier's Opera House. It is filled with sculptures, and every one of these sculptures has a name and a meaning and an artist, and it's the facade itself is like a stage set for the drama that takes place on the facade. The show, once again, remember the theme of the Garnier Opera House is the show on stage is not the only show. The show is in the lobby, the show is on the stairway, the show is on the street approaching, and here's a case where the show is on the facade. All the world is a stage in 19th century Paris. We talked about H.H. Richardson and his creation of the first truly American architecture. His work is widely considered to be very beholden to the Beaux-Arts tradition, especially in elements like the Trinity Church, where you see a very strong symmetric aspect, and you see the free play of elements. So his architecture is based on the Romanesque tradition, which you will recall was dominant throughout European religious Christian architecture before the Gothic. And he freely plays on the Romanesque. In Trinity Church, you see it produced in an extremely symmetric manner. But in his other work that we looked at previously, we see him break from the symmetry, and especially in his New England libraries and train stations, we see highly dynamic, asymmetrical works. Here's another analytique drawing. This was a tool that was used in the École des Beaux-Arts to study the works of antiquity, where students would draw the plan, they would draw the section, they would draw the elevation, they would draw the details, and they would collage all of these things together to determine and establish a relationship between the parts and the wholes. And the word analytique in French is the same as the word analytic in English. So this is an analysis. This is a method of analytical drawing. It is not a passive reflection of the architecture. It is an active tool of plumbing the depths of architectural thought. So this is very much about digging into the ideas of architecture and figuring out what is driving the architectural principles that are being employed in any specific work of architecture. And so this was a classic first year architecture school project where students would be assigned a building from antiquity and they would produce an analytique, and of course it was a competition and there'd be a winner and lots of losers. Another term, what's a French term that you use in architecture studio? Yeah. What is it?
What's that mean?
Unparalleled. And what do you do when you have a review the next day and you're not quite finished yet? What do you do? You pull an all-nighter. What is that in French? Do you ever use the word charrette? Do you use the word charrette? Raise your hand if you use the word charrette. What's a charrette? A charrette is where you sit down and, except for bathroom breaks and coffee, you don't move. You focus on one thing and you do that one thing until the deadline, right? Where does that word come from? Does anyone know the story? So students would be given an assignment, and this is going to happen to you, I bet, if it hasn't happened already. Has anyone done something called an en loge in class? Well, Wentworth professors are infamous for doing this. You will show up in class, in studio, and your professor will say, okay, I've got a little surprise for you today. You are going to design an entire building today during studio. You haven't done this? So I suspect this will happen before you graduate. And they'll say, okay, you have 5 hours to design a building. This is called an en loge, which is a French term from the Beaux-Arts. It means in your lodgings. It means what they used to do, they'd get an assignment, they'd go into their lodgings, lock the door, produce a complete building design, plan, section, elevation, perspective, site plan, everything. And it would be due at a certain time, and a guy would come down the hallway of the dormitory, basically, with a cart, or a charrette in French. And the cart would come by, and as the guy with the cart passes your door, he'd knock on the door, you put your drawings in the cart, and the cart proceeds down the hall. En charrette refers to the practice of, I just have a little bit more to draw, and so students would get on the cart itself and keep drawing as the cart was rolled down the hallway. You haven't heard that story? So that's where the word charrette comes from. Every architecture student should understand how deep the roots of the Beaux-Arts tradition run through the veins of at least your studio professors. So the Beaux-Arts tradition was a big deal in France, but it also was a big deal everywhere else in Europe. And because Europe was the colonizer of the planet, it was a big deal everywhere in the world. So every country you go to today, you will see Beaux-Arts buildings. Every city that you have ever lived in is dominated by a huge collection of Beaux-Arts buildings. Can you name one? This building is not a Beaux-Arts building, but it has been influenced by the Beaux-Arts. Its symmetry, the ordering system of the facade, is very much beholden to Beaux-Arts principles. There are other buildings not far from here that are absolutely Beaux-Arts buildings. I have points here in my pocket. The public library, the Boston Public Library, points. Another one, even closer, Matt. City Hall. Symphony Hall. Points. Yes. The MFA is the one I was looking for. Multiple points. Right, the MFA. It is a classic Beaux-Arts example. Completely symmetrical until IMPE and until Foster. But its original construction, completely symmetric. These two facades, one is grander than the other. You know, what's the front of the MFA? Take your pick. It's two very bold, large buildings. So one of the places where the Beaux-Arts took off was in the United States. It had a lot to do with the rise of the United States that we talked about when we were talking about Chicago. It became increasingly important in terms of its manufacturing, in terms of its commercial production. Remember, Chicago was a giant machine for sucking commodities in from the vast landscape of the Midwest, sucking them in through the cattle cars and the railways and all the road system. And everything was funneled to Chicago, where the meat was butchered, the timber was processed, any industrial process was produced in and around Chicago, and then it was shipped out to the world, either back on the railway system, through the Great Lakes, to overseas destinations, and that is still happening. So Chicago was the key to mobilizing North America as this profoundly massive machine for producing the goods that the world needed, and refrigeration of railway cars was a big part of it. The rise of the skyscraper, the 1893 Columbian World Fair, World Columbian Exposition was a big part of this. And so we have something around the 100 year anniversary of the Declaration of Independence around 1876. We have something we call the American Renaissance. And this grew and grew and grew. And eventually, by 1893, the World Columbian Exposition was very much a confirmation that the U.S. was the new standard bearer of Western civilization, or at least it was in the minds of the boosters of American exceptionalism. And here we see in the dome of the Library of Congress, I don't know if you can see it, can't really blow that up, can you? Okay, in the next version of the lecture, I'll do a zoom in. And basically the point of this is we see these different European nations, and then you see Egypt, Judea, which think of that as being Israel and its surrounding places, Greece, Rome. Islam is treated as if it's a country. The Middle Ages, Italy, Germany. It's just a very interesting portrayal of the sense of hierarchy of world civilizations and what the contributions are in each case. And in the case of America, it's the forward-looking, modernizing, on-the-move, growing, expanding force of civilization. And part of this, as it evolves, the Beaux-Arts eclecticism is moving beyond the constraints of classical architecture. Do you remember this section? This is of John Soane's house in London. And like the École des Beaux-Arts, it was used as a laboratory for collecting samples of the architectural elements of world civilizations. And to come to this home and to study its elements is to, it behaved like an encyclopedia. So here we are, remember lecture one was all about the Enlightenment and how important the encyclopedia was as a way of ordering human knowledge into a singular universal system. And here we have architectural encyclopedias showing up in the L'École des Beaux-Arts and in John Soane's study in London. And so you have this increasingly important idea that you collect the best of what the world has to offer, no matter where it comes from. And so this connoisseurship of human genius from Greece and Rome to begin with, but increasingly other civilizations. Islam was one of the elements in the dome of the Library of Congress. And so we start to get this opening up beyond the classical. And so we get to the term eclecticism. The term eclectic means it's open to sources beyond a narrow range. Today we call it cultural appropriation, right? Which is one of the greater sins, supposedly. But that's only true if you refuse to understand the way culture works. How does culture work? Should we stay in our own lanes and only deal with things that come from our own familiar cultures? Or should we swerve a little? Are you familiar with this term, cultural appropriation? So raise your hand if you've heard this term, cultural appropriation. Maybe you can explain it to me after class. I'm probably misunderstanding it. But my understanding of how cultures work is that elements of cultures move and they slide from one place to another. For example, when I write something using handwriting, I don't feel an ounce of guilt with appropriating the cultural achievements of Lebanon, which used to be called Phoenicia, which invented writing. When I order out dinner and I get Chinese, I'm okay. I like Chinese food. When I learn a new language, I don't feel out of place, like it's who am I to speak a new language. As a matter of fact, I lived in Asia for 5 years, and I went days without speaking in English. Good thing I didn't have these hang-ups about cultural appropriation, because I would have been in big trouble. I would have had to stay in my closet. I would have had to stay in bed all day. So, in a way, this move of eclecticism is the opposite of having a problem with cultural appropriation. It was, but maybe in a way, when you start to see the culture, the liberties that are taken with these movements of cultural elements, you start to reproduce the anxieties that are underlying the idea of cultural appropriation, which has to do with not behaving responsibly with those cultural elements, which is at the core of the critique of cultural appropriation. And so here we have the École des Beaux-Arts moving out from the Greek and Roman elements and starting to explore some of the other cultural forms available through a global understanding, expanding archaeological discovery of the rest of the world. So, these are These next two slides are summarized in this slide, so we don't need to go into it. But this American Renaissance is occurring in the United States through the language of Beaux-Arts architecture, at the same time as it's beginning to open up and embrace a sense of it's possible to move beyond the limitations of Greece and Roman architectural forms. And so if you are looking for an example, as might come in handy if you're facing that first quiz question I showed at the beginning of the lecture, what is eclecticism and what's an example? What specific features of a specific building can you point to as exemplifying eclecticism? Well, here's one. This, and basically you can refer to this as the Marseille Cathedral. Marseille is the coastal port of the south of France. So it's a French city in the south of France, Marseille, and they have a cathedral that is exemplifying what we mean by eclectic. It has Roman arches. There's a Romanesque use of building materials. Remember the Romanesque when you studied it? There was a mixture of colored stones and leaving some coarse and leaving some, polishing others into a smooth form. There are Renaissance elements, as you see in the archways that are then filled in. There are Byzantine elements that we see in the use of small domes from Byzantine, and you remember what the Byzantine architecture is. It's the early Christian Roman architecture of Byzantium, which is the empire that was centered on Istanbul, which we now call, I mean Constantinople, which we now call Istanbul, right? It's in Turkey. So this city in Turkey, Constantinople, now Istanbul, was the center of the Eastern Roman Empire that had its own architectural style. And then finally, as if to really make it more of a mix, it contains the oblock method of colored stone stripes that comes from the Arabic Islam practice of striped courses of masonry. So if you're looking for a clear example of eclecticism, this is a good one. Another good one is Sacré-Cœur. Who's been to Sacré-Cœur, Paris? And who's seen the movie Emilia? Emily. Is that the name of that movie? One of the great movies of all time. The whole movie takes place around this neighborhood of Paris and Sacré-Cœur Church. So Sacré-Cœur means Sacred Heart in French, but we don't say Sacred Heart Church, we say Sacré-Cœur because we're very familiar with this place. So this is a mishmash of different elements. In particular, the shape of this dome, this elongated dome, is what we think of as being going out of bounds. This is not clearly precedented in the Renaissance architecture favored by the original Beaux-Arts movement. So this is moving in the direction of greater eclecticism. It is, to a large extent, a replica of Greek cross churches. It is influenced by the Cathedral of Pisa, but it's improvising on those themes and introducing things that are previously out of bounds, and so kind of exploring new territories. It's so white because of the travertine marble is from a quarry where one of the characteristics of this particular travertine from this particular quarry is it gives off this calcite deposits where it becomes a powder, and so every time it rains, the facade, the powder gets washed away, leaving a pristine surface of white. So it's a quite miraculous accomplishment that they discovered, this travertine whiteness. And the inside is more familiar, but you start to see elements from the Byzantine practices of the apse. And it dominates this part of the north of Paris, up on this hill, in a very medieval manner. In a similar strategy for domination and monumentality, you see this 1882 construction in Rome, where it's copying what you studied as the Palatine Hill, the Capitoline, by Michelangelo. Remember that? Your teacher last fall said this would come up again, and here it is. It's come up again. So Capitoline Hill by Michelangelo is right behind this monument, and you can't see it because this thing is so big. And it's kind of ridiculous how big it is. Who's been to Rome? So, did you see this? You can't not see it. It's in the middle of everything. And who's seen this before? Where have you seen this? It was in a movie. What movie was this in? There's a better view of it. What movie was this in? That's a trick question. It's been in dozens of movies because it's the most fantastical piece of architecture produced in the 19th century. I saw it when I was like 9 years old in Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Did you ever see that? And how about Anne Hathaway's princess movies? What were those movies called? Ella Enchanted? No, the Anne Hathaway ones, where she's the Princess Diaries. Is this in that? I think it's in the second one. You didn't see those? But have you seen this before? So you look at this and you say, oh my, this is so old. But is it old? No, this isn't old. This is pretty brand new. People were not building like this in the 19th century. They were building train stations. They were building this is after the building of the Crystal Palace. This is the architectural function. So in this course, we're always saying, what does the architecture do, and how does the architecture do it, right? That's how your exam was structured. Say, identify what the architecture is doing, and then show and explain how the architecture is doing it. So here's an example. What is this architecture doing? Well, if you didn't take an excellent few courses in the history of architecture, you might say, oh, it's being old, right? But no, this is about the same age as the Eiffel Tower. It's not old. But yes, its job, the reason this is here, is to pretend that it's very old. This is an escape fantasy for the insane King Ludwig of Bavaria, Germany, who is nostalgic for a time when being a king meant something. Kings have castles, and goddammit, I'm going to have my own castle. So he's a spoiled little brat. He wants to escape from the world. Don't send this picture to Donald Trump, because he will want one. Right? So he was a big fan of the operatic works of Wagner. And he wanted to live in a Wagnerian opera, and so he commissioned this castle. If you ever have to shoot a movie, this might come in handy. So here's what it looks like on the inside. So this whole project is an extreme cartoonish version of the kind of things that architecture can and has done in the past. Please don't model your refurbishment of annex building after this castle, right? How would you do that? Yeah, don't do that. Or you could. There's enough space on the page, right, above the facade that you could put in a tower. So this is like architectural pornography. You shouldn't look at it too much. There's the grotto. We have to have a grotto. And there's the plan. When we get to the plan, it actually seems quite rational. Who was the architect who loved modularity in their plans? Durand, who said that? You get some points. Yes, Durand. Remember Durand? He was teaching at the Polytechnic in Paris, not the L'École des Beaux-Arts. I can say that now, because there's two approaches to teaching architecture. One is the art school approach, L'École des Beaux-Arts. One is the Polytechnic approach, Institute of Technology. We still have that. We still have that division. There is an organization called the Polytechnic. I don't know what it's called. But basically, every year, all the Polytechnic faculty and administrators get together, and we have a conference, and Wentworth goes to that one. I don't know if there's Beaux-Arts or Fine Arts would be the English equivalent, but we still have a strong association. 200 years after the Polytechnic École des Beaux-Arts split happened, that split is still with us here in the United States. Okay, Richard Morris Hunt, he was in the quiz question sample. He must be important. I usually delete all the portraits of architects because this is not about the architects, this is about architecture. But I didn't get around to deleting Richard Morris Hunt's picture. Anyway, he was the first American, and by American I mean person from the United States. We don't really have a proper name for that. And he was the first person to come back from the École des Beaux-Arts to establish a practice in the United States. And he produced dozens of buildings for the rich and famous and for the institutions that they patronized. And so let's look at that. So this was an early skyscraper. What was happening around this time in Chicago? So the Monadnock building, there was a steady series of innovations, the elevator, the use of wrought iron, and eventually the use of steel allowed people to get away from using masonry as the structural bearing material of facades. Remember the Monadnock building? And so this was an offshoot of that exploration of possibilities in Chicago. Every once in a while, one of the interesting experiments in high-rise construction would occur in New York City. This is one of them. Here's Cornelius Vanderbilt's mansion on Fifth Avenue in New York City. Cornelius Vanderbilt, remember we saw the map of Nebraska and the rail line going across? We saw on this map this swath about 80 miles wide of the new rail line, the Transcontinental Railway. Remember that slide? So in order to finance the railway system, the US government said, hey, railway companies, we will give you the land 40 miles on either side of your railway right-of-way, and we'll give you that land. When you build the railway, the value of that land is going to go up. We want you to take that money, the profit from the increase of value, and use it to finance the construction of the railway system. Go. Right? Wouldn't it be great if we could finance the subway system of Boston that way? Every time they increase the service frequency of the Orange Line train, the real estate value of Wentworth, not that Wentworth would ever notice such a thing, but the real estate value around every station on the Orange Line goes up because you don't have to drive, and Longwood real estate value goes up. So wouldn't it be great if we could do that now? Well, we can't. But Cornelius Vanderbilt was given all of that land to finance the construction of the railway. And you can tell by what he then built, it turns out that that was more than enough money because he came away with one of the greatest fortunes in human history. And he used that fortune to build these buildings with his favorite architect, Richard Morris Hunt. This one. And then the coup de grace, to use a French term, the most opulent. This is the equivalent of Ludwig's castle in Bavaria. This is down in Asheville, North Carolina. Who's visited Asheville, North Carolina? Hey, did you go to this? You did? You took a tour? Okay. Yeah, it's hard to miss. Yeah, so the Biltmore Estate, logical enough plan, crazy opulence, insane amount of land, and just a dominating presence on the landscape. And then why not? Let's do some more. So Newport, Rhode Island, the cottages of Newport, Rhode Island, right? They're called cottages. This is a cottage. But he also did institutional work as well, like the Metropolitan Museum of New York. So there are a few quintessential Beaux-Arts buildings in the United States, and this is one of them. The MFA is another one. Grand Central Terminal in New York City is another one. There were a few that are just tremendous examples of the pinnacle of the Beaux-Arts style. So this is a candidate. I think if I were the donor for the fortune that it would take to rebuild the annex complex, I'm a big fan of this, those double columns. Would you say this is plastic? Who would say this is a highly plastic architecture? Raise your hand if you think it's highly plastic. Raise your hand if you think, no, this isn't plastic, it's stone. That's not what we mean. What do we mean by plastic, again? What does it mean to be plastic in an architectural facade? Sculptural. It means there's a lot of depth to it. It's not just a flat sheet of glass like, is the Hancock Tower, which is more plastic, the Hancock Building or Trinity Church? More plastic. Who says the Hancock Building is more plastic? Who says Trinity Church is more plastic? Yes, points. Okay, so this is a highly plastic facade. Lots of sculptural innies and outies. It's the English muffin of architectural facades. Lots of nooks and crannies. And yes, the Boston Public Library, one of the great Beaux-Arts buildings of Boston. Have you been in the inner courtyard? Don't miss it, it's the best part. What building does this look like that we've studied in this course? What? Bibliothèque Saint-Geneviève? Yes, by who was it? Henri Labruste, 1841. Okay. The base, the pedestal of the Statue of Liberty is a work of architecture of note in and of itself by Richard Morris Hunt. And so now here we are back in Chicago. Remember, we were talking about what architecture does and how does it do it. In this case, the Beaux-Arts is, what is the mission of the Beaux-Arts? The mission of the Beaux-Arts is to elevate, it is to pump up, it is to establish the prestige, the authority, the status of the client. And in this case, the client is the city of Chicago and the young nation, the 100-year-old nation of the United States. On the occasion of the 400th anniversary of the discovery, the European discovery of the Americas. And so the wedding cake, the biggest wedding cake of all the wedding cakes at the Chicago World Columbian Exposition is the administration building by Richard Morris Hunt. And there it is at night, all lit up. Remember, electricity was a new thing in 1893. What was the first place that really went crazy with the light bulb? What is now known as the City of Lights? Just shout it out if it comes to you. Paris, yes, thank you. The Eiffel Tower was encrusted with light bulbs, and now it is once again when you go back. So here's another part of the World Columbian Exposition. So whenever something like this happens, there are at least three things going on. So what is the architecture supposed to be doing here? It is pumping up the prestige of Chicago and the United States in the eyes of the world, right? The United States is saying, hey, look at me, see my Beaux-Arts architecture. And so there we have it. That's number one. The first thing it does is it establishes the prestige of the United States and Chicago in the eyes of the world. But what's a secondary impact of that? What other audience is being served by this architecture? If the first audience is everyone outside of the United States, what's the second audience? The citizens of the United States. And so the first audience is saying, pretty impressive for a young country. But probably more important is the secondary audience, which is the citizens of the United States themselves are saying, look at us, we're pretty hot, right? It's a self-esteem prestige project. The third thing that's happening is it is making the careers of a whole group of architects. McKim, Mead & White, Daniel Burnham, Louis Sullivan, H.H. Richardson, all of these young architects are becoming household names. They're becoming superstars. As a matter of fact, comes later. And in that club, in that boys' club of famous architects, is the first woman graduate of the first school of architecture in the United States, MIT. And Sophia Hayden was the architect of the women's building, because couldn't quite wrap our heads around giving even a talented woman anything but the women's building at this time. And so here she is with the plans of the women's building. In order to land this commission, she has to overcome barriers that no one else, none of her other colleagues have to overcome. In order to graduate from MIT, she has to overcome obstacles that none of her classmates had to overcome. In order to be accepted to MIT, she had to transform the institution such that they had to get comfortable with the idea of admitting a woman into the architecture program. And here we are 150 years later, more or less, and it's still, we're still struggling with this. So change happens, but it happens a lot slower than you want it to. And so one of the things that, as we mentioned earlier, one of the things that happens with the World Columbian Exposition in Chicago, it's so impressive that it leads Henry Adams, who was one of the foremost intellectuals of his age, to say, long after we forget the names of the millionaires and the politicians, we will be talking about these great geniuses who produced the Chicago Exposition. And he's talking about William Morris Hunt, Henry Hobson Richardson, these two sculptors, who, if we have more time, we talk about Saint-Gaudens, who is a very important sculptor. Burnham, McKim, Mead, and White, these people are destined to become the heroes of American culture and to be part of this American Renaissance, the rise of America on the world stage, foreshadowing what happens in World War II when the United States emerges as one of two superpowers in the post-war period. So the momentum of this World Columbian Exposition in Chicago is so strong that it establishes a whole new movement of not just Beaux-Arts architecture, but Beaux-Arts architecture set in a new approach to urban design. And so the downtown area, the civic center of every city in North America, either transforms according to the model of the white city, or at least prepares to transform. It's a very expensive thing to clear out your civic center and rebuild it in Beaux-Arts style. Not everyone can do it. And so some places do it like crazy, and other places just entertain the possibilities. Chicago was one of the most important places because it was the host of the World Columbian Exposition that established the idea of the white city, which then morphed into what became known as the City Beautiful Movement. So at the core of Beaux-Arts principles is this idea of beauty for the sake of beauty. So art for the sake of art, art for art's sake. And the City Beautiful Movement, the primary driver of this was Daniel Burnham, who designed the World Columbian Exposition in Chicago. And he simultaneously, or almost immediately after the success of this, started working on a plan for Chicago. And here's one of the iconic images of the Civic Center of Chicago that was never built. And do you recognize some of the ideas here? What does this remind you of? Paris, yes, and Haussmann's diagonal boulevards, and especially the relationship between these wide streets and these monumental architectures. Where do you think this plaza and City Hall building is? You got that fixed firmly in your brain? Okay, now find where it is. Go get it. This is like a bloodhound thing. Find the Civic Center. Where is it? Do you see where it is?
There's no trouble finding it because it's right there. It's kind of like when we looked at Paris and then we looked at Hanoi.
So the genealogy of this, it started way back in Rome. I mentioned Pope Alexander, Pope Sixtus V, the transformation of Rome for pilgrimage uses. That happened 1,000 years ago. And then much more recently, Haussmann used some of the same principles to transform Paris. Those ideas became very popular. It became the basis of not just Paris and Hanoi and other French cities, we mentioned Casablanca, but here it is taking on a new life, being reborn again in Chicago. And here's another view of Chicago. So Grant Park is there by the waterfront, but the rest of it was never built. But it was built in other places. So the official date of this predates the Chicago plan. But all of these things were happening at the same time in Burnham's office. And this is the transformation of Washington, D.C., returning to the original 1791 plan of L'Enfant, who, you remember General Lafayette from France, he came over and helped the colonists win the war against the British in the Revolutionary War. Well, he came with someone else, this guy named L'Enfant, who was the original designer for Washington, D.C., for the first president, George Washington. And here it is, Washington kind of fell apart. They built a railway through the middle of the plan. And McMillan, with a Senator McMillan, with the design of Daniel Burnham, restores the glory that is the original idea of Washington, D.C. And so the fact that there's no railway cutting through the middle of the mall anymore is a result of this plan that came out of the City Beautiful movement in the aftermath of the Chicago Exposition. San Francisco, same deal. Some of it was built, some of it was not. The Civic Center of San Francisco, who knows San Francisco? Vanessa is here, so I guess that's the Civic Center. Wait, there's Market Street. Anyway, somewhere around here is the Civic Center. So this part of Burnham's plan was built. And this is often the case. Burnham would produce a plan that would transform an entire city, and they would build one part of it. Cleveland is one of the most complete. I'm not going to show you Cleveland. We don't have time. But here's a big part of this. The American Renaissance was not just something that happened within the United States. It's also associated with the new imperialism. So there was a burst of European hubris that said, we are the most civilized nations in the world, we're the most powerful, our industrial might depends on the commodities of the colonized world, these primitive peoples in Africa, South America, and Asia. It's our job, no. It's our right, it's our God-given requirement that we dominate these peoples, suck the raw materials out of their landscapes, bring them to the industrial giants of the North and process them and become filthy rich. United States, are you in? And the United States says, I guess so. We were a colony that threw off the yoke of English imperialism, but if we're going to be powerful, I guess we'll join in. And so, yes, the United States had its own colony in the Philippines. It's a long and complex history. It was preferable to the Spanish colonialization that dominated before them. And we didn't fight the Philippine people, we fought the Spanish to conquest, in our conquest of the Philippines. And Daniel Burnham does a plan for the Philippines. And here it is, for Manila, the capital of the Philippines. So the same ideas, you see it all the elements are there. Some of it was built, most of it was not built. Now here's an interesting twist in the story. And this is part of my mission in teaching this course is to disrupt the, have you noticed the way we study these things? We say, okay, here's what's going on in France. Actually, it's not France. Here's what's going on in Paris. And then here's what's going on in London. It's not even England. Here's what's going on in London. And then if we're really feeling open to the whole world, we talk about what's happening in Berlin. And every once in a while, we take these excursions to Hanoi and Casablanca and elsewhere. Well, here's one of those. My job in teaching this course, my mission, and hopefully you're okay with this, is to disrupt this Paris, Berlin, London, Paris, Berlin, London, Chicago isolation of the history of architecture. Because these things are global. And so here we are going to Japan. And Japan is a very dramatic case because around 1650, they got so sick of the Dutch and Portuguese missionaries converting all the people to Catholicism that they killed and threw them out. There was a movie recently with the guy who plays Han Solo's son in Star Wars. What's his name? Adam Driver. So Adam Driver was in this movie called The Silence about the missionaries in Japan. Did you see that? Anyway, so the missionaries in Japan get all kicked out, and Japan passes a law. They say no one is allowed in or out of Japan, and any ship, because they used to have a lot of trade with Korea and China and Vladivostok, they used to have trade all over. But they made it illegal to have a boat that didn't have a big hole in the side. So you can't take it out in the ocean. The waves would sink the boat. So basically, Japan made it impossible for any contact to occur between Japan and anyone else in the world between 1650 and 1854. So what happens in 1854? Who took U.S. history? Who took world history? What happens in 1854 in Japan? What was it? The U.S. does something. The guy's name is it Matt Perry or is he a celebrity? Matthew Perry? It's some guy named Perry. I don't know his first name. But Commodore. We call him Commodore Perry. He sailed into Yokohama Bay and he says, "You guys, do you see the cannon on my ship? You guys are now trading partners with the United States of America. Welcome to the world of global trade." And they have to give in because Matthew Perry, or Commodore Perry, we'll call him, has guns on his ship. And so they are humiliated. Japan is humiliated. So what happens when you humiliate an emperor? He gets back. He gets mad. So what does he do? What does the emperor do? Does it say here? He does what any emperor does when after being humiliated. He says, "I'm going to take over the world." Right? And so if you want to take over the world, who are you going to call? The architects. Thank you. You're getting the hang of this. I'm pleased. And so he calls the architects and says, "Okay, I need an architecture to help me take over the world." Well, first he says, "I want industrialization. Check. I want technology. Check. I want military power. I want all this industrial technology to produce armaments, a defense industry, and an army that can then take over the world," which you need, because if you have an industrial revolution, how do you feed the industrial revolution? Right? What do you need when you have an industrial revolution? What do you need? Money. Where do you put money? You steal the commodities of the rest of the world. See, if you're going to be architects, you've got to know what these clients want. They want to colonize so they get the raw materials, because you need the raw materials to feed the Industrial Revolution. Remember, I told you that When you studied this in high school, you had slavery, right? Slavery was a thing that brought cotton. You know, slavery was a thing, and then you had your test, and then you had a new topic. You had the Industrial Revolution. So you studied those things as two different topics. But what we know now is that's one thing. There is no slavery, there is no colonization, or it would have been much, much smaller unless you have an Industrial Revolution. You can't have an Industrial Revolution unless you have a cheap workforce and a lot of raw materials. So you need colonization and you need slavery. And so the architect isn't the first person the emperor of the Meiji Empire calls, but right in there in the top five. And so he calls the architects and says, architects, I need an architecture for taking over the world. What you got for me? And the architects say, well, can I interest you in this Beaux-Arts architecture? It's all the rage in England. And so he looks at these buildings in 1888 in London, and he brings over the British architects. The British architects train the Japanese architects, and the Japanese architects start producing these Beaux-Arts buildings. This one is Yokohama port opening building. I won't be teaching you the second half of this semester because I'm going to be hanging out in this building for a conference. I'm very excited to see the building in person. It's going to be very cool. So here's another one. So this is Tokyo train station. It's a Beaux-Arts building directly copied from England. This architecture means one thing in its original form, in its original setting in England. It means we're dealing with architecture as an appreciation, as a mixture of all the best material practices, the best art. It's art for the sake of art. It's art for art's sake. But then when it shows up, it's the same architecture in Tokyo, but it's performing a different task. How is it possible that two buildings that are more or less identical, right, let's go back. How is it possible that two architectures that are more or less identical, but are in different places and are performing completely different functions and purposes? And I don't mean program. I mean the job of this architecture in London in black and white is to say, let's have beautiful buildings and beautiful cities with all of this wealth. What's the point of having this industrial wealth if we can't have beauty? It's all about beauty. But when you bring it to Japan, it's all about power. And so here goes Japan. Off they go. 1895, they take over Korea. And then they head into the Soviet, used to be the Soviet Union. And they're moving aggressively into China. Here they do it again. And they take over Taiwan. They take over Korea. They take over the Vladivostok Peninsula. They move into Russia. They move into Mongolia. They move into China. And eventually, when Hitler is marching on Poland, the Japanese are taking over all of Southeast Asia, so the purple areas of Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, Burma, Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, the Dutch East Indies, the Philippines, all of these areas are being conquered by the Japanese because they are the new imperial power. And they're using this architecture to establish their power. So the last building we're looking at here is the Japanese headquarters in Taipei, Taiwan, to consolidate their control and of Taiwan. And so they have a competition. And Nagano develops the building on top. He wins the competition with this design on top. But they're getting ready to build it, and the Japanese colonial forces say, no, not Beaux-Arty enough, not big enough, not monumental enough, not strenuous enough, not enough power. And so they go from a six-story tower to an 11-story tower. And look how they beef up the corners. And this is the new architect, Noriyama, who is beefing up these corners. And they're talking about not just the defensibility of the building, so it is actually functioning as a fortress, an architecture of defense, but it's also exuding power and strength and defensibility. It is a fortress. And so it's an interesting case, this building. Taiwan is no longer a colony of the Dutch. It's no longer part of mainland China, at least if you talk to anyone outside of mainland China. It's also not part of the Japanese Empire anymore after World War II and the nuclear bombs. It's now called the Republic of China, or what we know as Taiwan. And so here's Taiwan, and it's now the presidential office building. So it's an interesting case. I don't know if I ever showed this slide bigger. So here it is, and it is a Beaux-Arts building, but it's performing a completely new function of Japanese imperial power. And after it changes hands, it continues to convey power, which is what Beaux-Arts buildings do. It's why we love the Beaux-Arts. If I said, find this building in the plan of Taipei, you'd find it, right? It faces east because Japan is the land of the rising sun. Do you see it yet? Point to it if you see it. Someone sees it.
So you think it'd be where these things converge, but it's not. It's actually back there. It says government office. And you,
while you were looking for this building, you probably saw other buildings that look kind of like it. That's because there are Beaux-Arts buildings all over Taipei today, because the Japanese built lots of symbols of power all over Taipei to establish its imperial authority over this conquered land. Did the same thing in Korea, in Seoul. Did the same thing wherever it went. It had incredibly big plans for Shanghai when it took over Shanghai. Here's the plan of the building. And so there's this very interesting, we don't have time to dig into what's going on here, but this very interesting structure in front of it. But something, everything else is a lot more familiar. It's almost a plan of the annex building. It's almost a plan of the Museum of Fine Arts. The strategies are the same. Here it is in later years. Here's the inside, exuding authority, which is why we call in the Beaux-Arts architects. We need to exude authority. We want to make the most of our investment in this architecture, so we put it on our money. And then we use it, even though it's European to the bone, we apply whatever needs to be applied to make it a vehicle of national identity construction. So here we are, exemplifying the identity of the nation state of Taiwan. And if you are Taiwan and China is getting bigger and bigger and bolder as the United States gets more and more weak in its negotiations, to the